future our people deserve.
Hey everybody, welcome to What the Flick. Pardon our dust. We're in sort of a studio under construction.
Transitional period,
yes,
if you will.
And it's a weird time, so no one's here but Bibbs and me. Woo!
I'm Alonso. You know it's a slow day when I have to be here. When they let me do movies.
Alonso Duralde from TheWrap and Linoleum Knife, and this is William Bibbiani, of course, from Crave Online and the B-Movies podcast.
Hello.
Talking about this week's YA movie, Insurgent.
Yeah. Insurgent, okay. Insurgent is the sequel to Divergent. They're going to run out of urgent words after a while. Remember the end of the last one? Well, it just keeps going. Triss and Four and her crappy brother and Miles Teller are on the run. Kate Winslet has a Hellraiser puzzle box she's got to open, and only Triss can open it. Let's take a look.
Find them. Every last one of them.
Jeanine's never going to stop coming after us. It's time we fight back.
We don't have the numbers.
We will.
Jeanine claims you're all dangerous insurgents. If we were to combine forces, we'd be unstoppable. Can't let anyone else die because of me.
Chris, help me!
She's the one.
This is the only chance we have to rescue what little civilization we have left.
Dark times call for extreme measures. Let's begin.
Okay, I'm going to say this right now. I don't dislike the first Divergent. There's not much to it.
Oh, but I disliked it.
It was on like HBO the other day when I was doing something else, and I found myself just sort of idly not turning it off.
Okay.
Like, it's a simplistic, kind of dumb, like, half-hour Twilight Zone metaphor that they really stretch out too far, and that's basically all there was to it.
My thing with Insurgent, aside the all the sort of what Dave calls the YA Mad Lib, putting all that aside, I never buy this world.
That's the thing. That
doesn't make any sense.
The world is stupid. The world is this very, like, I would buy, that's my point when I say Twilight Zone. I would buy this if it were 20 minutes long.
Yeah.
And I don't have a lot of time to think about it. But the more time I have to think about it, the more I think, so the whole point is everyone gets split up into, depending on what your value and your values are,
your abilities
or abnegation or whatever. And almost the entire populace is either one thing or the other.
Yeah.
And I'm like, that's not the way society works. And that's why I feel that Divergent, more so than even something like Beautiful Creatures or The Mortal Instruments, there's something just kind of rote and stupid about it, because it tells you that the main character is special just because they think in a couple of different ways, like literally everyone does.
Yeah, I know.
So you, in the audience, you're special just because you were born, basically. And there's nothing really dramatic about it, and so it always seems really forced.
Yeah,
and
it's a clunky metaphor, and it feels like one of those 1920s sort of early avant-garde, like The Adding Machine or something, where it's like, get it? This is what this is representing, And it just I never buy into the world.
Yeah,
there was the other problem I had with Divergent was the fact that there were like four supporting male characters who all looked identical. So like, which one is that again? Like, there's that guy, there's that guy, there's that guy, and there's Miles Teller.
Well, Jai Courtney was the one with the eyebrow piercing.
Right. Well, he was at least blonde.
You go.
And Mekhi Phifer is the black one. That
but
helps,
again, what I will say for the first Divergent is that it moved along at a clip. It really didn't focus too much on the world so much as, isn't it cool that she's been with these bunch of like punk soldier guys and they go ziplining and it's fun.
The cast of Godspell.
Here, they're on the run and it gives them an opportunity to sort of visit the various groups that got the short shrift in the first one, like Kander and Amity. But the problem is that the plot is so focused on the concept now that if you don't buy the concept,
there's nothing else.
There's nothing else to distract you. There's a couple of fun little action sequences. sequences, but there's also like all this new technology. And bear in mind, it's only been like a week since the events of the first film, and there's all this new technology that really would have just saved Kate Winslet's bacon in the first one. Like, she would have won if she'd had this technology a week ago, which obviously she would have.
The parts that I liked in this movie were these sort of VR simulations that, Triss winds up having to go into to open the magic doohickey.
The lament configuration.
Whatever, yeah. And so I at least thought, okay, now you're taking me out of that stupid world and just putting me into this simulation, into the danger room, and that's kind of fun.
Yeah.
And that was sort of interesting. I you know, the movie kind of perks up a little when an actual actress over the age of 30 pops up, you know.
Naomi Watts is in this, and she acquits herself well.
She's fine. Yeah. Octavia Spencer, you know, is one of the best things in it. You know, she's in it far too briefly.
The best thing in this movie is Miles Teller. He just breezes in through the movie and doesn't give a shit about anything. And he's like Han Solo in Star Wars. Not that he's that good, but that what was great about Han Solo was everyone else was so fussy and taking everything so seriously, and Han Solo was just like, I don't give a shit about the Force, I got a blaster. That's kind of what Miles Teller does so it's refreshing when he's on camera.
He kind of takes a step back from it and is sort of like, meh, and I think a lot of audience members are also kind of going, meh.
Yeah.
This is just a snooze.
It's just weird. The VR stuff, it did start picking up towards the end, and I remember seeing the Super Bowl commercial for this, which was one of the weirdest commercials I've ever seen for a movie, because it's just Shailene Woodley waking up in a glass room, staring Kate Winslet in the eye, fucking like pounding through the wall, and then she punches Kate Winslet into Legos, and then she's falling out the building, and the whole world is just destroying into Legos. And when any of that stuff is going on, it's at least interesting to look at.
Yeah, exactly.
But then it just...
And you don't have to have to be committed to it because you know it's all fake.
Yes.
Which the really rest of the movie is also fake, but it thinks it's telling you something.
Exactly. I couldn't help but shake the idea that all of these things, there's this bit where, you know, Shailene Woodley's hanging from a room that's on fire or something. Mm. No spoilers, it's just weird. I couldn't help but get the feeling that this is just here for the video game tie-in.
Probably. Even
right down to Negatris, which just, it's a stupid palette swap in video games, and it doesn't work much better here. What was weird about
when she's strapped to the ceiling, I just kept thinking, I haven't seen Coma in a while.
What was weird about, I want to talk a little bit, and I'm really not going to give any spoilers for the ending of this, but I do want to say there's something sort of off-putting about the ending of this movie for me, in that it ends. It's not a cliffhanger ending in like this sort of like, I realize that might sound like it's a spoiler. Trust me, it's not. I've seen the movie.
There's more to be unfolded in.
I don't feel like there was. I feel like I got a satisfactory ending to the movie, and I know there's two more. I don't want to see any more. It ended for me. You wrapped this up. The metaphor is concluded. There was a reasonably satisfying, you know, sort of solution to everything, and now I'm done. It's not like the Avengers where all of a sudden Thanos shows up at the end. I'm like, okay, well, Thanos will come by, and that'll be kind of neat. Nothing like that. It's just over, which is just a weird thing to do in a franchise that's designed to set you up for two more movies.
I could see where they were laying groundwork for other stuff to happen, but you're right. Because I'm so not committed to any of this, I could just stop now, frankly, you know. But
it's weird.
And of course, there's one more book, which means two more.
It is two more movies. I don't know. But here's the thing. I don't know what to expect. And normally that would be a good thing, like, oh, how exciting, I don't know what to expect. But when the story just feels complete, I don't want to expect anything. I want to just enjoy that, oh, well, you actually had an ending for that.
It does kind of feel like, oh, we got canceled. Oh, wait, they're picking us up for another season.
That's exactly what it feels like.
Parks and Rec, you know, like, oh, shit, now we have to
The ending of Buffy the Vampire Slayer season 5. It just cuts to the tombstone. So like, oh, shit, well, that's it. And then you got to figure out what to do next.
Right.
I assume they have an idea, but it really even feels like, even in this movie, like, the way that they reestablish that there's more plot feels really tacked on. Like, oh, yeah, Naomi Watts was after this cube thingy. Yeah. I'm like, was she? That seems like something maybe you would have mentioned before. Like, it feels like there was an afterthought.
Yeah, and also the way the first movie sets up what the factionless are like.
Yeah.
Seems to have gotten that completely wrong, or just they were all misinformed. I don't know.
I don't even know. Anyway, it's not that good.
Last thing I want to throw out. I think Shailene Woodley is a terrific actress.
She is.
This is the first movie that I have seen bad acting from her.
She's not asked to do much.
Throughout, but there's that scene where, and I don't want to get into spoilers, but she is under sort of a chemical influence.
Yeah.
boy, is she like just
she's really
big, overdoing everything. And yeah, this is worth pointing out. This is directed by Robert Schwentke,
yes,
the guy who gave us RIPD and The Time Traveler's Wife.
Yeah.
How many strikes do you get?
But this one's gonna make money, so this sort of resets his career in Hollywood. I feel like what happens is when these sort of franchise movies, you get someone to start it off who's a bit of an auteur. Mm. Not that Divergent did, but you look at someone like Gary Ross, for example, when he started off The Hunger Games, and then it's almost like they did something too interesting with it. And then you get someone who's just more of a genre filmmaker to come in and just machine gun through the sequel.
I guess, but you
and
know
do them just rapid fire.
Get a non-shitty genre filmmaker next time.
I don't think here's the
That's
this
my
movie
vote.
Here's the thing. I don't think this movie is shitty. It's just so generic and not terribly interesting. There's like a couple of moments here and there that perked my attention, but honestly, it doesn't go anywhere. It's not a terribly clever metaphor. I ended up giving this just a 5 out of 10, middle of the road. I will forget this existed.
I gave it a 4 because, yeah, there are some moments that are kind of interesting. And like I said, the further away it gets from its own self and into a world of nothing, then that's actually more interesting. And,
yeah,
you know, I liked some of the performances. But, yeah, Shailene Woodley. This is the first time I've ever seen her, and I thought, wow, that's...
Again, they're just robbing her of character stuff to work with, and it's really sad. So that's a 4.5 from us. Where is it on Rotten Tomatoes?
It is a 35 on Rotten Tomatoes.
Wow.
So
if you thought we were rough, everyone else is worse.
Pretty much. But, you know, I think this is that kind of movie where if you're going to see it, you're already going to see it, whatever we say, and if you aren't going to see it, no one's going to convince you. So you
didn't need to watch that. You completely nullified the entire review. Thanks, Alonso.
Thank you.
Our opinion means nothing.